Good evening and happy Halloween. Growing up in the 80s and 90s in Europe, we didn't really have Halloween. I mean, we still don't really have Halloween today. To me, it was always nothing more but a special themed episode on a TV series. So tonight, I want to talk about three of my favorite Halloween episodes, each from a different series. In 1993, Chris Carter created the X-Files. X-Files became such a massive hit that Fox asked Chris Carter to make another TV show. Fortunately for me, he had another idea, focusing specifically on the upcoming millennium. The millennium, if you weren't there to live it, it was a massive, crazy moment going to the year 2000. There was crazy panic, people thought the world would end, computers would crash, and Chris Carter figured he could like mooch off that fear. So in 1996, we got Millennium. One of my top three favorite shows of all time. Back in the day, once both shows were airing, you were either Team X-Files or Team Millennium. Now, I absolutely love the X-Files. I followed the X-Files, but I definitely stood more in the lonely corner of Millennium fans. Even to this day, Millennium is really hard to find and to watch anywhere, save from buying the DVDs, which fortunately I own. Millennium is gritty and dark and it's brutal, and I absolutely love it.
Prior to these stab
The show has only
wounds,
three seasons, and a steep decline in ratings unfortunately led to its cancellation. To me, the show ended in a good way, but they felt inclined to create a new ending in a season 6 X-File crossover episode, which I vehemently detest. They tried to give a certain spin to Millennium in the X-Files show, and I always hated it. It made no sense considering what Millennium truly was about, the real fear of mankind. Millennium follows Frank Black, played by the brilliant Lance Henriksen, an ex-FBI profiler specializing in getting into the mind of criminals in order to help authorities track them down. The brilliance of this show is that Frank Black profiles criminals by getting into their mind, but not in some weird thing like CSI or Profiler or all these other shows. Frank Black sees criminals for who they are. This is so brilliantly displayed in the show, where, for example, a young man shoots a guy. That's what you see because that's what happens in real life. But the way Frank Black sees it is the way the criminal experiences it. The criminal, in his mind, he's conveying a message of God. So he's smiting the person. The person is struck by lightning after he quotes the Bible.
By Uriel and by Raziel, powers, principalities, thrones, and dominions, I bind and command you, stand. I, Samuel, bound by his will, command you, depart. You son of a bitch.
Thank you. example, you can have a terrible mass murderer, and Frank Black, he sees the evil in people. He sees who they are. So to him, they walk around like demons. And that is just such a unique perspective. The show is not a surreal show at all. It's dark and gritty and focuses on real horrors of mankind. But Frank Black's vision of these horrors is what makes the show so unique.
I was overcome with relief. Plus, it's been such a long time since I notched a soul.
You see, you've still got it.
Just like riding a bike.
But that's when I saw him. I don't know who he was or what he was doing there. But he knew what I was. I could just tell.
You must be so lonely.
There! He merely mistook you as a grieving boyfriend. Nothing more.
He thought your relieved sobbing was hysterical sobbing.
Yeah, I told you. This man has no idea what we truly are.
You must be so lonely.
Frank is part of the Millennium Group, a secret society with a larger agenda, which is specifically you get to see more in season 2. So what set this show apart from me was the incredible dark atmosphere it had, combined with very explicit murders, often in gory detail. So during season 2, Chris Carter focused more on the X-Files movie and X-Files season 4, to the point that when he came back to Millennium for season 3, he wasn't happy at all with the direction they had taken the show, which was just less brutal, with too big of a focus on the Millennium Group itself. For a show that's already dark, gritty, and explicit, what could you even do for a Halloween episode to make it scary? Well, they absolutely succeeded with the episode The Curse of Frank Black, which aired on October 31st, 1997. The Curse of Frank Black took everything that made Millennium great and amplified it. It is an absolute atmospheric masterpiece and truly one of my favorite Halloween-related media. We open this episode with Frank Black sitting in his house, carving a pumpkin, getting ready to take his daughter trick-or-treating. It is a pure Halloween episode. Strange things happen in the episode. The pumpkin he carved lights itself up after he leaves the apartment. The numbers 268 and letters ECT seem to follow him around during the episode, and he keeps seeing demonic figures, which, again, by itself is not unheard of, as I mentioned before, but made very creepy in correlation with the Halloween setting. I don't want to say too much of the episode, because I feel it's definitely something you should experience because of how atmospheric it is, but there's definitely a Halloween setting throughout the entire episode. Between the pumpkin carving, the trick-or-treating, we have kids telling ghost stories. We get flashbacks to recent terrible events that happened in the show, like just episodes ago. And we keep cutting back to Frank's past, which is reasonably rare already by itself for Millennium, where he met a World War II veteran traumatized by the loss of his fallen comrades. The focus is heavy on ghosts of the past and the dead, with a veteran from Frank's past hoping to communicate with his friends. As he says on Halloween, the veil between the living and the dead is the thinnest. Which is pretty ironic considering the next show will be attacking, which actually claims the exact opposite. But I always like this idea of storylines in Halloween where, oh, the evil is more thick at this time, like evil is more thin at this time. There's a lot of shows and movies that always use this, and I don't know, it really adds to that Halloween atmosphere, I feel. In parallel to this, in the present, Frank is being bothered by his own traumas, accumulating in a message from a biblical verse. Why should he be thought incredible by you, that God raises the dead? The main thing that sets this TV show apart from other Halloween episodes from other TV shows is the imagery. The curse of Frank Black is slow. It's haunting. Not much happens in it, really. It relies heavily on the sounds of trees, the empty streets, scary houses, expressions of characters. Even the trick-or-treating itself feels desolate to a certain degree, almost unnerving. I haven't gotten into too many of the nuances of the episode, because I feel I already talked more about the episode than I should, because it is without a doubt an episode I'd recommend to anyone who loves a spooky, standout Halloween experience that really focuses on the subtle horror, atmospheric horror. The second TV show I'd like to talk about is Buffy the Vampire Slayer. Now, a lot of people know Buffy the Vampire Slayer, so I'm not going to go into a deep dive of this franchise, and I really want to focus on the Halloween episode specifically. Buffy is a teenage girl destined to hunt vampires. It was created by Joss Whedon in 1997 and was based on his own movie from 1992. It was a creature of the week type show with usually a red thread leading up to a finale of some sorts at the end of each season. There are so many absolutely amazing episodes in Buffy that it's honestly a shame if people don't appreciate the show and miss out on these individual episodes. The Hush, for example, is an amazing episode where the characters lose the ability to talk. Demons come in town, they steal people's voices, the demons are absolutely scary. One of the people is Doug Jones in the suits. They're like the gentlemen. That's what they're called, the gentlemen. They float around, they steal people's souls, and people lose their voice. They can't talk. So the whole episode is in silence. It is such a brilliant idea. Another one of my favorite episodes happens way later, where one of the characters is lost. So everybody is looking for them. So they go find a vampire to talk to who might know where she is. And as the group is talking to this vampire seems like he lost his mind. He's completely out of there for like several weeks already in the TV show, several episodes. He's lost it, his mind is gone. So the people are talking to him, and it makes no sense what he's saying. It's like he's having two conversations at once. But the absolutely brilliant thing is that he is having two conversations at once.
There's a body.
Tragedy.
Is there blood?
Yeah. And I can't find Buffy or Xander or Dawn. And there's this thing killing people. And the victim was skinned. What could do that?
You did it once. I heard about it.
Anything other than me?
Look at you. Glowing.
What's that word means, glowing?
It is such a beautifully written episode. But today, we're gonna focus on a different episode. Very perfectly called Halloween. Halloween aired on October 27th, also in 1997. And, man, Halloween episodes in Buffy are usually so much fun because they establish, like I said before, that in this universe, contrary to belief, Halloween is when the real demonic activities are at its lowest. Without diving too deep in the nuances of the relationships between all the characters, here's what the episode is about. In this episode, Buffy, Xander, and Willow are tasked by the principal to help the children of the town trick-or-treat. So they all go to a shop, they buy their costumes, they go out on the street, and they help the children trick-or-treat. That's the basic setup of this episode. So the beginning of the episode is a little bit slow, but it sets up the story as to why these characters dress up the way they do. Xander, for example, is bullied in school, so he dresses up as an army man to feel stronger. Willow is trying to come out of her shell, forced by Buffy, let's say it like that. So she starts by dressing out kind of provocatively, and then she gets embarrassed, and so she just puts a sheet over her head saying she's a ghost. And Buffy herself, in love with Angel, is trying to impress him, so she dresses up as an 18th century noble girl. What follows is beautiful chaos, because everyone becomes the costume they put on. So Xander becomes an actual commando, and what's great is that he actually keeps the knowledge he gains throughout the whole series. Willow becomes a ghost, well, a sexy ghost, and things go wrong because Buffy, who's the slayer, becomes an actually 18th century noble girl, so they make her ditzy, powerless, she needs the help of a man for anything, meaning they lose the slayer, so everybody's now in danger because of everything that's happening. On top of this, all the children also become actual monsters as they become their costumes as well. So Xander, now equipped with live ammunition, is about to go on a rampage and is barely stopped by Willow, who with her ghostly immunity is going to seek help. Xander wanted to go full force on monsters, you know, at children, is just absolutely hilarious. Like, it sets up like a lot of comedic moments. The reason I love this episode so much is it's just filled with Halloween aesthetics. You know, the way everything is decorated, the trick-or-treating, you have the actual costume shopping. Just the plot where people become their costumes is just so hilarious to me. I absolutely love this idea. You see a bunch of variations throughout the episode. Now, not to go too deep into the Buffy lore, but season 2 introduces my favorite villains. It's Spike and Drusilla. Spike becomes a main character throughout the rest of the show. I love Spike. And Drusilla is driven mad by Angel's evil alter ego Angelus in the past. So Drusilla is like this old school vampire who's just completely mad. She lost her mind. And just, I always love the relationship between Spike and Drusilla, specifically early on. And the situations that arise in this episode are just crazy, funny, it's lighthearted, with heavier implications for the rest of the show, but those don't matter in this episode. The last Halloween episode I wanted to talk about is from my favorite TV show of all time, MASH. I'm a bit of an old soul. MASH is even a little bit before my time. My grandfather used to love MASH. My mom told me this years later after she noticed that I was a real fan of MASH. And I don't know, I always liked that connection I had with him. In 1968, Richard Hooker wrote the book MASH, a novel about three army doctors, that's the actual full title, based on his own experiences as a MASH unit surgeon. MASH stands for Mobile Army Surgical Hospital. So in 1970, a movie based off that book was made, and in 1972, a series was made based off the movie, based off the book. MASH to this day has the most watched finale of all time of any primetime show. 10 years ago, I feel, it was only beaten for the first time by the Super Bowl. Like, that's how huge it was. That's like urban legends going around that after the finale of MASH aired, everybody went to the toilet at the same time and there was a whole massive draining issue, a plumbing issue throughout the country. It's like crazy. Like, it was that huge. There's some controversy surrounding the show involving actors leaving unhappy with how their characters are being treated. And for example, the audience displeasure after Alan Alda, one of the main actors, took over creatively, often having the show's detractors refer to MASH as the Alan Alda show. Personally, I think that worked in its favor, that Alan Alda became more involved creatively. I feel the humor was more effective and the drama just went much harder.
What the hell do you think you're doing? I'm taking out that guy's appendix in there. You gonna get into your whites or what?
You're talking about removing a healthy organ.
No, I figure his appendix is about as sick as his mind.
Doctors aren't supposed to take bodies apart. They're supposed to put them together.
Why, so guys like that can take them apart again? You heard him. He's going to take those kids up that hill tomorrow and send them back to us in pieces.
That man is crazy. That doesn't make this right. Some things are wrong, and they're always wrong.
Fine, it's wrong. But there are going to be 100 boys still alive tomorrow. Go tell them how wrong it is.
Damn it! Why don't you just stab him? Cutting into a healthy body is mutilation.
Don't give me that. There aren't doctors back home who do unnecessary operations. You never heard of that? And for what? For a few bucks.
All right, suppose you get him relieved of his command. What about the guy they send to replace him?
He's going
to
be better than this guy. He's got to be.
You don't know that for sure, do you?
So I'll take them one at a time. What have I got to lose?
Just your self-respect, that's all. You're a doctor of medicine. You cut into a healthy body, and you're going to hate yourself for the rest of your life.
I hate myself right now. I hate me, and I hate you, and I hate this whole life here. And if I can keep that maniac off the line by a simple appendectomy, I'll be able to hate myself with a clear conscience.
All right, you want to play God, you do it alone.
Fine. If you're going to keep talking about it, put a mask on. I don't want to run the slightest risk of infecting him.
So, MASH uses a laugh track, which I hate, which fortunately on the DVD you can turn off. Even the show's creators were against this laugh track, but CBS kind of fought them on this. So in the end, it was a compromise where during the operating scenes, there wouldn't be a laugh track. Outside, there would be a laugh, but it's fake. Laugh track is not a real live audience. I feel no show should have a laugh track. No movie should have a laugh track. It's absolutely ridiculous. Anyway, the episode I want to talk about today is very beautifully named Trick or Treatment. It's a season 11 episode that aired November 1st, 1982, one day after Halloween. To me, at this point, the show is at its best. There's two actors that leave in season 3, there's another actor that leaves in season 5, there's another actor that leaves around season 7. I say around because they kind of phase him out. And so in season 11, the final season, honestly to me, the cast is at its best. The episode is nothing super crazy, but it's always been one of my favorite Halloween-themed episodes, and it's actually the only Halloween-themed episode in the entire 11-season run of MASH. So everybody's getting ready for Halloween. Everybody's dressing up, but then there's an influx of wounded coming in. So everybody's forced to go to the OR, the operating room, and treat all the casualties. And then the episode switches between the ghost stories they start telling in OR and the crazy cases they have outside of OR. So for example, Major Winchester's treating somebody who has a pool ball lodged in his mouth, somebody who tried to stick his hand into a fan. He gets all these weird crazy cases, whereas Pierce gets like a really serious case of a soldier who's so heavily traumatized he doesn't want to eat anything. While all this is going on in the beginning of the episode, before they all go into the OR, one of the wounded is already deceased. So they put him to the side so that they can make place for all the other wounded that are coming in. There's three ghost stories they talk about during OR. Colonel Potter's story revolves around his wife once dreaming her brother came to visit her, and then the next morning he had passed away. Not only that, but his wife's sister had the exact same dream. Hawkeye's story is about how his uncle was once lost at sea. He was led back to the coast by a large ship who they learned had sunk 20 years prior. And then Margaret's story is about a photo taken of a car accident that, after being developed, showed the victim standing next to it in the clothes he was buried in. These are short stories. MASH, compared to the previous two shows, is only 20 minutes long. So they're kind of just short stories they're talking about. And Major Winchester keeps being dismissive of these stories. He thinks there's like a logical explanation for anything going on. I love this episode for many reasons. Again, it's like the only Halloween episode in the entire show, which is really unique for a show that went on for 11 seasons. But I also really like the idea of telling ghost stories all together. It's just the campfire just being swapped out for OR. I also like the cases that are being treated in this episode. There's a vast juxtaposition between the stories of Winchester's patients that I mentioned before, which include like a soldier with a pool ball stuck in his mouth, and one who stuck his hand in a fan, like Winchester's mocking disbelief of each situation's stupidity. But then, opposite of that, you have the horror of Hawkeye's patient that is literally starving himself and he can't understand why. Finally, between the stories of these patients and all the ghost stories, we get a ghost story of our own in this episode, where the soldier who was dead in the beginning comes back to life. Okay, actually, he was never dead. But still, it's a pretty cool twist. Father Mulcahy, who's one of my favorite characters, he's the priest of the camp. He comes back from a mission that he was on, and he discovers the soldier. And he knows, as he's giving him the last rites, he notices the soldier is still alive. It sets a very eerie vibe for a while that just stuns everybody. There you go. Three of my favorite Halloween-themed episodes from TV shows that I absolutely love. Tell me if there's some Halloween-themed episodes from shows that you really enjoy that stood out to you. I just like the mix of beautiful, unnerving horror and then the contrast of just the lighthearted fun of enjoying Halloween, sharing ghost stories, the aesthetics. There's so much that these shows can offer depending on what kind of show you want to watch. Definitely let me know what some of your favorites are that you maybe remember from your childhood. I could have made this list a lot longer. I talked about different TV shows still. There's so much more out there that I love. We'd be sitting here for hours, and this video is already longer than I would like it to be. So I hope you enjoyed it. Please comment and definitely subscribe for more content. Horror content, goth-related content. I did a vlog where I was walking through the catacombs in Paris, haunting. I did a video where I reviewed the new Alien movie because I absolutely love horror as well. You see reactions, trailers, dark tourism. You find anything spooky on my channel. Thank you all for watching. And as always, be kind to one another, even in the dark.